Hey, it's Jamie Moore here. You're very welcome to the Off the Ball League of Ireland podcast. A very special episode for you over the next 45 minutes or so. I'm happy to welcome three former League of Ireland players who are most recently and next season playing their football north of the border in the Danske Bank Premier League, lads. Is that what it's called officially?
Yeah.
Yes, so we think so. Yeah. So three men beside me, nearest to me, playing for Glentoran, Gavin Pearce, next is Owen Weir and playing for Glenavon, and over in the corner, Joe Gorman of Cliftonville, who recently qualified for next season's Europa League qualifier. So lads, you're very welcome. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks for having us.
Joe, start with you firstly. Tell me about the Europa League and the big win recently.
Yeah, well, we played against Gav, and it was a tough game. Wasn't really much in it. A mistake at our end would have kind of won the game, but no, we were happy enough just qualifying. There was a lot of pressure on us. So, obviously it brings the holidays shorter, but it's worth it in the end.
Yeah, for those listening and watching, the league up there is a bit different in terms of European qualification. In the League of Ireland here, it's if you finish in the top three or win the cup. But in the north, if you finish seventh, as Glentoran did, you can still actually make it all the way to Europa League. How does that work?
Yeah, well, I think top three is supposed to get Europa League, but unfortunately, you didn't, did you, Tom?
No, I missed out this year, unfortunately.
Which I think should be fixed, to be fair, because they've done very well in there. But I think 4th, 5th and 6th and 7th play in a playoff, and then obviously 7th, we end up getting Glentoran in the final. So we ended up doing all right in the end.
So all three teams were involved in the Europa League playoffs?
Yeah.
And it's strange because you finished ahead of both of those, is that correct?
Yeah, that's right, Jeff, finished in 3rd.
But didn't qualify for Europe?
No, funny enough, actually, we finished in 3rd on 70 points, which was a record for the club as well. And so having broken a record for a points tally and not qualified for Europe, it was disappointing in the end.
Yeah, were you aware of that when you were signing in January, that you were going to be likely in the playoffs, but even if you finished 3rd, you weren't going to be automatically in?
Well, actually, before Christmas, I think we were top up until the end of November. And the second phase of games started to drop a few points, and in January then there was a few changes. So when I came in, I realised that the club were done well for most of the season, and I think we were in 3rd or 4th when I joined, so we managed to maintain a good run of games then between then the end of the season. So
Gav, you guys finished 7th?
Yeah, I was the opposite. We were struggling when I got the phone call, and I think we were around 9th or something like that, and went in, and I suppose used my experience and helped the lads around me out, and we managed to go on a little run. I think we were unbeaten up until we lost against Cliftonville.
So the league also splits halfway through, doesn't it? How does that, because you guys were playing in the second, so you're playing against a team from like 7th to 12th, was it?
Yeah, it splits on 30 games.
It all depends as well who wins the Irish Cup, because Crusaders won it.
Yeah.
They finished 4th. So if you win the Irish Cup, you automatically qualify for Europe.
Okay.
It would have been down to 6th, I think, would have been. And
Crusade,
then 7th wouldn't have been in. Because they'd already won the league or qualified
Crusade
for Europe.
Yeah.
And they won the cup, so they're automatically in the Europe. Then what happens here when someone wins the cup goes down the place? So that's how we managed to creep in.
So what was your memory of, I suppose, your 6 months or so there since you joined?
Yeah, it was good. To be honest, I thought I was going to retire, really. I was hemming and hawing. One day I was retired, the next day I wasn't because I get a phone call. Then I went in to Cabin TD just to have a look, because I was going to look at the coaching side of things. And then I was nearly going to do that, and then I just got a phone call out of the blue, and that came up. And I went up, they were playing Newry, and I went up, had a look, and I just got a good feel about it. A good stadium. The game wasn't great when I was there. I went and watched that day, but you could see that if you put a bit of effort in, it can be big. You know, the whole league can. There's some good stadiums up there, isn't it?
Yeah, it's decent.
So you went in, and the club were probably not going to end up getting relegated, but at the time,
no, we were fighting.
Sure, really? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I actually didn't know. I just had a little quick look then. I was like, oh.
It's still signed though.
Yeah. So I went in, and I backed my own ability. I knew if I got fit and got playing games, that we'd be all right. Because I looked at the game that day, and Glentoran were miles ahead of Newry at the time, you know. So thankfully, we went on a good run, and you know, we sort of brought a bit more success to the team.
They have some good players like on the team. Even when we were playing, wasn't it a long ball game kind of in that final? It was literally, to be fair, we saw out the whack heading the balls away.
Yeah, so suits me.
What was the game like? He won, you lost, obviously.
twice now. We should have beat them twice as well, I think.
Yeah, it wasn't really much in the game. No,
they didn't have a shot.
I
think until extra time, I think, or maybe the end of the second half.
I found it weird because the goalkeeper wasn't taking that kick out. And we were like, what's going on here?
Were you taking them?
Yeah, myself and the other centre half. Felt like I was backing under eight.
I'm assuming he must have been injured, was he?
Yeah, he'd done his medial.
Okay.
And he was playing through it, so we had to go back and take them. And then he got to a stage where, because we were kicking it and they were winning it and we couldn't get out, we had to say, here, just start kicking. So he did, and I think I think he was won it in midfield more so than that, and I think he's got on top in midfield and got second balls.
Because we knew if we kept that top three quiet, it would have been we would have won the battle, because the midfielders are good, and up top we're really good up top, might be one of the strongest in the league. But it could have went either way.
Yeah,
could have went either way.
Like, we had four clear cut chances. And we missed.
I think that's the thing with the league, isn't it? There's always a lot of chances. It's end to end.
But that's what they didn't. Was it Gormley or Donnelly?
Joe Gormley scored the goal before he was out.
He didn't have a kick, and then extra time because the other centre half had to go off injured. New fresh centre half come on and wasn't up to speed with the game and just got caught cold, I think.
I'm just having a look here because you signed. Have you had two managers or three managers since you joined? The previous manager,
Gary.
But he was the assistant. Gary Smith, wasn't he? He was the assistant.
He signed me. He came in. Him and Lieber were the manager and assistant. And then Mick came in with Paul Miller.
Yeah.
Hey, Case.
I've enjoyed it since they came in. I enjoyed it when Gary was there as well. But I enjoyed it when the two lads have come in and, you know, just I'm enjoying my football. That's the main thing for me, is just about enjoyment now.
So explain to us who the current manager is, because he has a CV that has brought him literally around the world, worked with, is it Carlos Queiroz?
Yeah, I ran with him, I think, and I think he was offered to go to Colombia now, is it?
Okay.
Is that where he is?
I'll find out in a second. Google will tell me.
I think so, yeah. He was offered to go there, but then there's a new owner taking over, or they're buying Glentoran. So there's a big project coming there, and I think he might have something to do with that. And they're looking at building Glentoran up, really. Because years ago, it used to be Linfield and Glentoran were the big two, and you know, I think there was 8,000 people at the Linfield and Glentoran game there at Christmas time.
Still the equivalent to like Bows and Rovers now, League, isn't it?
Yeah.
The biggest game, yeah, I think.
So I'm looking forward to that one.
Yeah.
First time playing Stevens Day in, I don't know how many years.
That's the thing, I was saying that all on the way up. It's going to be different this year because I'm going to be playing on Stevens Day and like New Year's Day and all that. So, we know drinking wine on Christmas Day.
That's something much different to what you would be using in the league, because at that time of the league, you're getting ready for pre-season and you're not actually probably back in yet. Yeah. So you're similar to Gav. You joined Glenavon in January, having played in the League of Ireland for a lot of your previous years and been in the UK before that. How did you end up signing for a team up north?
Well, I think, looking back at it now, obviously things didn't end particularly well with Limerick last year. With relegation, I'd missed the last 3 months of the season and had a knee operation in November on my meniscus. So the big thing for me after that was just getting back playing and knowing that the league was coming around in January. Actually, two or three clubs from up north contacted me straight away. With Glenavon being the closest to Dublin, it sort of suited me best because I'm doing a couple of other things on the side away from football, and obviously seeing where they were in the league and going up and seeing around the place, lovely stadium and stuff like that, and they sort of sold it to me, and I feel like I made the right decision. I've played pretty much every minute of every game since I've joined the club in January, and I've been fit, and you know, we've been winning games, and from an individual point of view I've done really well, so I've been happy with the move.
Are you playing in midfield or centre back?
I'd say majority of games I've played in midfield, but I've had to play a few at centre back, so
it's not strong enough for centre back up there.
three could be a great back three, actually.
Wouldn't be bad.
Him on the left, you on the right, him in the middle.
There is Jay.
Yeah, that's fair. So how have you found it in comparison to, like, if we look at your career in Ireland, Limerick, Bowes, Sligo, Bowes were your four clubs. How have you found that to what you've had in the last few months in terms of like standard quality crowd, stadiums, all of that?
Yeah, I think, as Gav said earlier, some of the stadiums are quite good and probably better than I was expecting. Crowds can be mixed again. I think there's a big gap between the top four or five clubs in the league and then the bottom three or four. I'd say that's the biggest difference for me in the league is the drop, probably. Like I said, between the top teams and the weaker sides. But overall, it's been good. It's a physical league. A lot of the games are at the end. There's a lot of chances. You're playing in midfield. There's a lot of running involved as well.
Sorry, Nick.
Yeah. So, you know, every game is different, but it is quite different to the League of Ireland and stuff. But so once you're playing, and I think we'd all agree on that, once you're playing every week and you're enjoying your football, and that's the main thing.
It's more physical, isn't it? Like, it's more battles. Down here it's more technical, you know.
Yeah, I'd say it's more 90 miles an hour is the best way to put it. It's, you know, it's probably less teams. Probably less teams play out from the back as such. There is some good quality players in the league, but it's a little bit more direct than it would be down south.
And you mentioned there about being back from injury, and you've had an interesting couple of years because you've been injured. And I think we sat down at the Kennedy Cup, was it last year? Was it just a year ago? Around this time last year, where you were at Limerick, and there was stuff going on with Limerick, and you were not long back from an injury. I think you could have been still injured then as well. So just to have got back and played kind of a half season, and a half season where the games, you know, were of a high level and actually really mattered because of what you're talking about, trying to make it the Europa League.
Yeah.
That was a big, reason why you went there.
Yeah, but the other big reason was the length of the contract. So when a club have offered you a 2.5 year deal, it's just rare in the league down here. It's hard not to take it, especially when you have had a couple of difficult periods of injuries and stuff throughout the years. It was a little bit of a no-brainer for me at the time, and obviously like that, seeing where the club was and where we potentially could be at the end of the season with a real chance of Europe. And I think that's the most disappointing thing, is that when you look throughout our squad, we did feel like we had the squad to be in Europe, and that we could have held around there and done well. And, you know, it's up to us now next season to go back to the drawing board and look at where we went wrong and hopefully go one further.
Is it weird for you two, because you've only done a short period of North, in the case of Joey's been there longer, to not be playing now, given you're in the middle of June and there's about to be a League of Ireland break, and that has been your kind of schedule for the last number of years, to now have like the summer off, maybe be able to actually go on a holiday that's longer than 6 days?
Yeah.
I've started a bit past that now. I've adjusted. I'm working with the FAI now, so like that's my job. The football for me is enjoyment, and that's my break away from my work, so I'm enjoying being away from it, but constantly always working.
For you, Owen?
I think it's a shorter off season, which is the big thing when you're used to down here. Probably the whole month of November, whole of December, you're probably talking the guts of 8-9 weeks off. Whereas up north, it's sort of being back in England. You only have your 4 weeks, and in Joe's case, you've probably only got two or three weeks because of qualifying for Europe. So. You know, you have a shorter off season, but like I said, I think most footballers would rather have it in the summer, where you can enjoy maybe one or two holidays. So
for you, Joe, you signed for Cliftonville in December 2018, so you're there kind of 18 months now, a little bit longer than the lads. How did you end up there, and how have you found your time there so far?
Well, I was over in Scotland for a bit, and I was struggling personally, a few personal problems off the park. So I was kind of, do I stay over there and kind of try fight it? Or do I just come home and be around the family? So Cliftonville came in to me before, and I knocked it back, but I thought it was the right move for me. I actually had a chance to sign for Gav's team, Glentoran, when Mark Smith was the manager.
Gary Smith?
Yeah. And he was the manager, but I just felt Cliftonville was the right move for me. They weren't particularly doing that well when I signed, you know. We got in a few players, and we seemed to, like, a new manager, Paddy McLaughlin, he likes to play a bit of football, so suits me. But going up there, I think I've learned a lot more about myself, like defending and that, because it's the physical league. You've got to become a better defender. Like, so look, I think I've kept 7 clean sheets out of 13, so I'm quite happy with that personally. And qualifying for Europe was a massive achievement for myself and the club.
Yeah, we'll speak more about Europe in a second. You've also played in the league here for Bray and Drogheda, Inverness in Scotland, Airdrie, and also in League 2 in Scotland for Clyde. And you know, it's been a theme in this podcast over the last couple of years, speaking to lads who've been away, about not being happy and not being, you know, being away from family and friends and that sort of stuff as well. And that was something that really made you want to come home in the end.
Yeah, well, look, it gets to a point where you have to look at the bigger picture. You know, you can chop and change every club. You see a lot of boys have a lot of clubs on the CV. To be fair, I just wanted to kind of settle down, spend more than a year or two at a club and just play week in, week out and just be happy about it. And the sort of lads will tell you, there's no better feeling than just going home after playing on a Saturday, just enjoying football. And that's the best thing about it.
Yeah, you've all used the word happy a few times since we've been speaking too. And, like, in your case, being in Scotland and not being happy, how did you try in that period to deal with that unhappiness when you were still in contract and you still had to stay there even though you didn't maybe want to?
The club are very like understood me, the situation I was in. My granddad passed away and they gave me a few weeks off. It was very hard for me and they were really couldn't speak high word about them. It was class. But I came home and done that PFEI. It's
the camp,
game.
Yeah.
And even that, I enjoyed that. And I just said, it just feels right, just being at home, my family coming home. Even the first game I played for Cliftonville, I came home, I sat on the sofa and I was like, "Mom, it's great that I'm able to come home to my family instead of going home to an empty house back when I was living over in Scotland." And that was the tough thing, a lot of downtime, you know.
And to be back with the family in comparison to being away from the family, and we had Ryan Burke in a few weeks ago, he's 18, 19, plays for Birmingham, and he's going into his second two-year contract, he's got a new deal, loves it, and says he's not homesick, but for everybody, it's just so different, and how you feel in comparison to the next fella beside you is very, very different, and then that determines how you deal with it, and when you do come home for a weekend even, in some cases, you actually don't want to go back to the airport to go back again.
Well, I think the big thing of being away is dealing with the setbacks. Because as a young lad, like, see if you get knockbacks after knockbacks, and it's just mentally it takes its toll on you. And I think even with injuries and that, you've had a few injuries on, and it's a lot. It's hard going. So I think if anybody just kind of, if you can get the mental side of the game right, you have half a chance.
Go on, Gav, yeah.
I think that's a big part of it. It's just finding somewhere where you're going to be playing week in, week out, and it's keeping you busy. And when you're busy, you haven't got much time to think, and then that's when you end up being happy because you're just playing and enjoying it.
I think similar to Gav as well, we've been a similar boat that having now got other things away from football, it allows you to just go out and enjoy it. Literally just go and enjoy it. The pressure's off, and like that, with the length of a contract, you're not sort of looking at necessarily your next move or what's going to happen at the end of the year. You can just go out and play, and you know, you can't underestimate that.
The difference from me when I was at Sligo, professional, head on, slept football, you know what I mean? Now I'm going up there and I'm working and I'm just driving up and I'm going playing football and I'm actually playing well and enjoying it without even thinking or I wouldn't say caring because you do care, but not as much, if you know what I mean.
It's not as all encompassing like as
other people. Focused on football, it's just you've other things going on.
I think it's a little bit more relaxed there in general, isn't it? Well, can only speak of our club as well, but they're very sort of accommodating to players who are doing other things away from football. So it's not a case that, obviously, yes, as long as you're performing and getting results and stuff on a Saturday, but they do make allowances for other things that you're doing. I think that's one of the bonuses about playing up there as well.
Yeah, I want to speak about, you know, the travel and stuff as well in a minute, and, you know, part-time versus full-time and that, but just to stay on what we were talking about with Joe for a second. Owen, you were in West Ham and you were younger. Gav, you had a short spell in Mansfield as well. Does what stories you hear from other people and from Joe sitting beside you resonate in your head about homesickness and sadness and unhappiness and you know, not wanting to, you know, wanting to be there for the football, but maybe not wanting to be there for everything else?
I think for me, anyway, I was over there, I think it was 6 years, and for the first 5 years, I can honestly say that probably didn't apply to me. I was living in London, absolutely loved it. I had family that lived not too far away, and, you know, all my experiences were good. I was playing whatever age group I played with, I was progressing and playing every week, and, you know, then the last year, all that completely changed. Done my first cruise year, the last year of your contract, then all the doubts start coming into your head, then you're away from your family and your friends, you're not being able to train and play, and that's when it sort of hit home at me. Do you know what I mean? First 5 years was fantastic as far as I'm concerned. That, you know, missed home, yes, but never thought about wanting to necessarily return. And then in the last year, you know, that's what I think happens. Incidents happen in your life and, you know, make you think differently, and it's sort of how you react. And like that, at the end of it, I came back and signed for Bowes and had the exact same feeling as Joe, you know, local side, back living at home, and back sort of enjoying football again. Yeah, there is. So, it does apply. Like, I think everybody's individual case is different. And
it was the same as that with Blackburn. Loved it, focused, flying, and then new change of manager, went to Mansfield. And I was doing flying at the start there as well, and then a change of manager again, and I hated it when he came in. And I got to Christmas time and I was there on my own on Christmas Day. I just said, I literally booked my boat to go home the next day on Christmas Day. I said, this is not me. And went home, wasn't thinking of football, and came back not knowing what to do. Ended up signing for Sligo and then went on and found somewhere where I was happy. I was playing, I was going on, we were successful, and then I suppose when I got my serious injury in I was 28, and that was when I suppose started to say, oh, what's going to happen if this happens again, or I'm coming to the end, or if I'm not the same. That's when I started to really focus on after football then.
How long were you at Blackburn for?
3 years.
Okay, so you went there as a teenager?
Yeah.
Okay, didn't know that, now I do.
Yeah.
So you had to move club in England, and again, you're at Mansfield, and like, was there an exact moment, like, you know, you've spoken to two lads about what they wanted and when they wanted to come back, and they decided they were coming back. What was that moment for you? Was it just...
At Mansfield?
Yeah.
We were playing Northampton away on Stephen's Day, and I was on my own in the house on Christmas Day, and travelled to Northampton and left in the stand instead of just saying, here, I'll bring a local lad, you go on home for the holidays and come back. And then I just went, no, that's me gone. Went in and said, look, can they cancel my contract? You know, all this pain up and this and that. I just said, no, I don't want that to do. I was gone.
Some clubs are just a piece of meat to them. Yeah. They don't really care. They say that, oh, we care about you, but they don't really.
I was pulled in a couple of months beforehand to say that, keep doing what you're doing. We don't know how you're not gone. Championship clubs have been looking at you. You know what I mean? And then a change of manager, and then how things change so quickly.
Yeah, it's the one thing I always notice when young lads go away and they get a squad number and it's like 107 or 95 or 38, because they just give every player in the club a number, as opposed to, you know, I even noticed this season at Shamrock Rovers, they have the initials of the players on the gear, as opposed to, you're not just a number. And that replies to your statement, Joe, about being a piece of meat, that you're in an academy and there's so many players, particularly if you're 16, you've got so many, you know, levels to jump, that if you don't do well, it's just see you later, lads, and that's it.
Because it's just like an escalator, and players just keep coming and coming, and just even lads coming out from Ireland, that, like, it's just the pressure and that, you know. Yeah. They expect, well, you've came out from Ireland, you must be a decent player, and if it doesn't work out for you, then see you later.
I think the big thing is for players that are let go by clubs, there's no sort of duty of care or following up on players once they have been released and checking on them and seeing how they are mentally and that, because I talk about, it's different if it happens to us now, we all understand the game and have been around the block long enough, and you know, now we know the positives and negatives that come out of being a footballer and stuff, but some of these young players, they're naive, the ones that go over. Parents are naive and stuff like that. And I don't think that support network's necessarily always there for players, and I think that's why you often see players coming away and, you know, mentally, you know, not in the best place and stuff, because it is difficult to take, especially when all you've been used to your life is, you know, being the best player in the best team and always being picked, and always, and then your first setback might come at 19, 20, and it's a big one, getting released. And you know, like that, players are a piece of meat. Nobody's really checking away. You sort of know who your real friends and your family are then when times are tough, you know.
You don't see many managers texting you, how are you getting on? Yeah. Where are you?
As in fellas who you've played for before?
Well, it depends. Like, if very close friends often you've played with, you don't see many of them texting you. Mate, there might be dead one or two. The rest of that, like, they don't care, because there is no, like, it's true saying, there is no friends in football. You're in it for yourself.
You count them on one hand.
Yeah.
And where, Owen, does that duty of care fall? Like, club, agent, parents, friends? Because, and we're not going to name any names of any agents, but there's lots of agents who absolutely love you and they're getting you your deal and they send you over and then you get released and they don't even answer their phone to you. And the club don't speak to you anymore, and your parents are trying to basically go and pick up the pieces of your career that you had a dream of, that is you know, has taken a bump because you've had to leave England. Like,
I find that I help people in the league if they need it.
Yeah.
Like, I've had players from different clubs come to me and ask me about different things, and I've pointed them in the right direction. I'd always help people because I know what it's like from experience, you know, with the injury, if they need help with that, where the best place to go is and stuff like that. It doesn't matter if I haven't played with them or not, but the league is so small that you can always give advice to people.
Whereas over there, it's a lot different. It's a bigger.
Yeah, I'm not saying that, you know, everybody's just looking out for themselves, but it kind of is like that. You know what I mean? And like Gav said there, when you've sort of being sure what we have and the two of us now following a career and coach and hopefully and stuff like that, and you're trying to educate young players and parents about what to expect, do you know what I mean? Not to always expect the yes, you want to be positive and have a positive mindset and yeah, I'm going to make it and yeah, it's going to work out, but you know, you can't put all your eggs in one basket in that case, and you know, people have to be, you know, prepared for life after football and stuff like that. Yeah, you know, it's not the be all and end all, but yeah, you know, to make it, you do have to be so, you know, tunnel minded, and you have to really want it and stuff like that. But I think you're talking about whether it's clubs. I don't think you're going to get it from clubs. You know, players come in and out the door year after year from clubs, so I don't think you're going to expect it from them. Yes, that should be as part of an agent. That is your duty of care to your. Your client or whatever, where what I'd say is I'd often with an agent, you'd want them to be a friend, you know, you'd want them to look out for your well-being more so than anything. So you know, whether it's the authorities as well, and there's somebody that should be designated, you know, to follow up on players and say it's a tough job. I don't think there's one way of doing it, but it's
that's why I enjoy doing what I'm doing with the FBI, because you're helping them progress in the football and education, so that they're going forward with either go football way or you can fall back onto the education, you know.
See when I came home, I wasn't even a member of the PFEI, even with Stephen McGuinness and through the SFEI over there, like they were great to me because they'd know, right, they should maybe look after boys that have probably played in the league, but like I don't even think there's one up in the north.
No, it's not.
And there's things that go up in the north that I've seen, and you're like, this shouldn't be happening, like, you know, that's what I mean, the care of the players, no one really cares about it up there, you know. As I said, you are just a piece of meat, but I think there has to be more of a kind of an emphasis on it up there. You know, we need to kind of bring it, like the PFEI down here, like with plenty of players that have seen it. Yeah. Even when I was at Bray,
yeah,
when the money problems started happening, they were great for me.
Yeah,
it's not really. You can't really do anything up there.
I think that's what we're getting at, is that, you know, when you see the job that Stephen and Ollie do down here, and it is fantastic, and I think nearly every player in the league that has had to deal with them, and that, you know, they do help you as much as they can. And but like in England, I don't think I've ever spoke to anybody from the PFA, you know, in all the years that I've been there, other than you might get the odd leaflet or booklet or something.
Remember,
you know,
for life,
I mean?
You have the card, that's what professional footballer.
Get you into a nightclub.
Yeah, get you into a nightclub.
Well, it has its benefits, I suppose, yeah.
I suppose just on the our last conversation, we do have to say as well, there is a small percentage of Irish lads who go and make it and stay there for 20 years and do great. And also, I only learned recently when talking to Sean Russell about Limerick and his surgery issues and whatever, that if you're not a professional in the League of Ireland, you can't be a member of the PFAI and they can't represent you. You have to be a professional in order to do that. So they're just two things that I learned during the week. So lads, you go from Gavin, your case, being over in the UK, crying on Christmas Day and getting the boat home the next day years ago, to playing in the Northern Ireland League across Christmas, which again is something new for all of you. Yeah. Playing Stephen today, playing in the middle of that period, and then New Year's Day as well.
There's a lot of games in a short space of time, isn't
so it? How is that? Because it's something I would love to have in the League of Ireland. Of course, we can't because our season's not on in December, but I like the idea of it, and I love being at home over Christmas and watching games on telly. And of course, it's a massive sacrifice for the players and the coaches, but the overall thing I think is cool. But what's it like to actually be in your first ever case of certainly in Ireland playing?
Me and Gav have a wedding to go to between it, so you know, that sort of breaks up the games a little bit.
The same wedding?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll have to give him a card now.
Is this next year?
This coming, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So who did you all play on?
I won the games.
Yeah, well. If your managers are watching now, you're going to make a plea to have the match off or just make the afters of the wedding?
Just don't get sent off.
Sent off at the woman, or even better, injured in the warm-up. Injured in the warm-up,
To be fair, I think me and Gav can't play three games in a week, so we might have an excuse.
So what's it actually like, though, playing across that period?
Well, we haven't played, yeah.
Of course. Well, sorry, Joe, I'm going to ask you because you did, because they were only signing. What's it like?
It is like, if we always say it, look, I watch TV and Sky Sports on Stephen's Day, and it's great, so I'd love to play on it. Even when I played in it, the atmosphere, everyone comes around, like it's like a community type of club around Cliftonville. Everyone came out and we played Crusaders, which is a derby, and I think there was like 3,000-4,000 at it. And it was great, the atmosphere was great. We got beat that day, but still there was a good turnout and the atmosphere was great.
And what do you guys expect from it, to have to go up next year and
I think we play Linfield, is that this set in stone?
Yeah, they usually do that, don't they? The two derbies so together, kind of.
It's supposed to be between 5,000 and 8,000 of it.
Okay.
It's like a ritual, so I'm looking forward to it. And you know, I actually mentioned it last year, the year before, that I'd love to see the league down here go that way, because I think you could push it in that way, and then again form a ritual of people playing each other, like Bows and Rovers playing each other on
imagine that
on Stevens Day. Like, that would be a big crowd.
Good, you like that for the league. It's about having
localise it and then just get more crowds. Yeah.
If you could have all the derbies on in the one day, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, it'd be great.
Over the course of a bank holiday weekend or something like that, you know, it'd be fantastic for the league. Yeah. Get a game on Friday, a Saturday, and a Sunday, or whatever it is, and spread them all out. It'd be brilliant. But I think the top process of the league and the fixtures down here, you'd see I think I read there yesterday or the day before, there's only 12 league games left or something in the first division.
I can believe it, yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So there's no thought really, and we're not even, we've just come into June. Mm-hmm. You know, whereas we're saying our off season is, you know, 4 weeks, and, you know, the other 11 months of the year, you're in season, you're in either pre season or your season started, compared to that sort of 10 week gap in the league and leagues. How many games have the lads played? And in the space
so
of
many
10
cups
weeks,
up there
do you know
well.
What I mean? Yeah. I think that some of them have played nearly 15 games in the space of 10 weeks. Like, it's crazy. Like,
Gav, I got you a present.
Yeah.
I've just found a Snickers under your feet there. Look.
Seen it there.
Full Snickers. Were you looking at it? Was I looking at it? You can have that if you want, but we pick it up. Who left their Snickers behind in the off the ball studio? Does anyone want it? Yeah. Off the brawl, was it? Well, who wants it? Can I?
Gav's raging. I don't know. Signed that up.
Is it in date?
I don't eat anything.
I have that with my cup of tea. It's from New York. This is from Madison Square Garden.
Wait in the off season.
Is this from the UFC or from Katie Taylor? Yeah. That's Katie Taylor. Yeah. Okay, nice. We got a
Katie Taylor. I don't say that.
You can have her for your next trip up north. That was my next question.
Does she get hangry? Does she?
Yeah, probably does. She'd absolutely batter you anyway, and all of us. In fairness, tell me about the commute, lads. It's not as far as you would think it is, but you're still up the road, 3 nights a week, 2 nights a week, plus your game, depending on when you're playing. And do all your teams train at evening times?
Yeah.
For me, it's we're based in Lorgan, so it's only an hour and 15 minutes from my house. So it's not too bad at all. Do you know what I mean? It's like I said, was a fact there, and one of the reasons we were signed for Glenavon, that I wasn't having to, you know, last year with Limerick, obviously I was living down there, but I was home quite a bit. I hadn't been coaching in Dublin and stuff still, so it was still the best 2 hours. Do you know what I mean? Back and forth, so an hour and 15 minutes is nothing. It's doable.
And are you in a car school, or do you just go yourself?
I pick one of the lads up from Newry on the way, like, so I'm on my own up to then.
Nice. What about you, Gav?
Yeah, it's on
your carpool mate is one of his best mates from Inverness, Conor Pepper, I believe.
Yeah.
Joe was smiling.
Doesn't stop talking, does he?
Never.
And I enjoy it. I only go up on a Tuesday because I have college. I'm in my final year now with my degree, so.
Jolly.
Thank one God day a week. That,
when that one day a week and plays, yeah?
Yeah. So, when I was playing against you, I was only training one day a week, remember that?
Still took the joke out of us.
There is a story which we were discussing before we came on about someone scoring a header on someone else. Owen was scoring the header. Is that right?
No, I scored.
You scored the header against Owen.
Don't score it.
Disallowed.
I don't remember that.
But it was disallowed.
Disallowed.
Now, you're 6 foot what, and he's not 6 foot what. So how did that happen?
Yeah, but anybody that knows him stuff. Knows.
Yeah, he can jump.
It's part of the movement.
You can jump. People. Okay, nice. So you're commuting up with, what, is it only Connor or is there anyone else in the car, just the two of you?
No, me and Connor, yeah.
Okay.
It's about an hour and 20.
Is that all?
Yeah. When he drives, it's about an hour.
Okay. And do you have to go through Belfast, or is it on this side, or?
I think it's just at the start of Belfast.
Just at the ground, no?
I don't know, I just go in.
Put the sat-nav on and off you go.
It's great drive, because it's just straight up, isn't it? Yeah.
You, Joe's are similar, yeah?
Well, we're Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, and it's an hour and 45, I'm by myself.
Okay.
So this is what I've been thinking. I'm thinking of moving up there.
Okay.
Because it makes more sense to me.
You're thinking of moving club?
No.
Moving house, Gavin. Don't be starting transfer rumours.
Well, I'm thinking of moving up there because it makes more sense to me. And sure, outside of football, like a coaching job up there.
Yeah.
I'm into my coaching. I'd like to give that a go up there. There's a lad I know who'd help me out with and get me a few hours. Just kind of life for after football as well.
Mm-hmm.
But it's more or less full time, like, you know, up there. And it is tough going, but it is what it is.
How do you occupy your time when you're driving? Is it just radio, podcast? Do you make phone calls? Because I you know, our office is in town in Dublin. I live in Howth. It's, you know, I'm only in the car for probably 40 minutes or an hour, and towards the end of that period, at the end of the week, I've run out of podcasts.
I've been listening to a podcast from over in Scotland, the boy Open Goal.
Okay.
Have you heard of him, though?
No.
It's pretty good. You should listen to it. It's a lot of music, but we're just annoying people on the phone. Just talking to people and boring the life out of them.
Yeah, it is, though. Like, you're up twice a week, Owen, is it?
Twice a week, yeah.
Okay.
And the lad that I pick up, Caelan Marin, from there, he doesn't shut up whenever I pick him up, so there's no point in having that on, do you know what I mean? Because you won't get a chance to listen to it, so...
I try to listen to news talk to try and get a few examples for my exams.
Well, go on.
No, just to try and tie into it, to use examples when you're, you know, when you're using my exams for my business degree.
Okay.
We've all just been around football, like, so it's a different for me doing that. Now, I've done well in it so far, but I just try and listen to that just to see if there's anything there that I can use in exams or assignments or something like that.
Brutal when it goes, and then it's snowing up in the north.
And the radio doesn't work?
There's nothing really works up there. I was snowing on the way up one day, and I was like, I'm not going to make training here because traffic was going so slow. And like, you're thinking to yourself, well, I have to do this all over and over again. The trip back, like, it's a straight road, it's not too bad, but you just.
We were told to turn around and snow.
Really?
Well, Gav, if you look out that window, Pat Kenny will be sitting right there, so you can say hello to him after and he can give you some business tips. If you want.
He's fancy doing me fine in the air for me.
He might, yeah, you never know.
Try to give him a few tips.
It's the Off the Ball League of Ireland podcast with Jamie Moore here. We're having a special episode this week speaking to three former League of Ireland players who are now plying their trade up north. Gavin Pearce with Glentoran, Owen Wearne with Glenavon, and Joe Gorman with Cliftonville. Lads, a question for the floor. Would an All-Ireland League work? LOI and Northern Irish League mixed with like a Premier and a First Division, or bring back the Satanta Cup for a couple of years, which is like the top four playing each other? I know we're going to have this Champions Cup with the champions of each league playing each other over a two-leg match, but you're all very well placed to answer that question because you're all playing up north and have played here recently. What's your thought on that idea?
I'd love to see it. Having been in the league, like you said, if it's a case where, you know, up north we've got, like I said, we've got a divide between maybe the best six, I'd say best A clubs, biggest A clubs, and then there's a bit of a drop after that. And if you could combine those A clubs into a Premier League down here with the teams that are already there and have a 16 or 18 team All-Ireland League, I think you'd be looking at a very, very strong league, you know, and it'd be like that. The stadiums and all the infrastructure up there, I think, you know, the foundations are there to do it. Obviously, there's a lot of ifs and buts of whether it could be done and stuff. But I'd love to see it at some stage, yeah.
Joe?
I agree 100%. Even like for televised games, I've been watching plenty of games as Glentoran against Linfield on Sky Sports and that. Like, and you only get really RTE in that down here. You can only watch the games, but I think it'd work. I'd love that.
And having played in the league here and been away and now up north for the last like 18 months, it's been talked about for so long and the different, you know, interests of the Irish FA and the FAI here, and of course at the moment we're not sure what's going to happen with the League of Ireland, but it does seem as if there is going to be some sort of link up for a competition of some sort now or the next while might be the time to try it. Like,
because like, it doesn't seem to be working out at the moment, does it really?
They've done the Stanley Cup, didn't they, at that time? So, like,
did you play in that?
Yeah, I played in it. Yeah,
but you won it actually in 2014, so you did play in it.
Yeah, no, but I was injured.
Okay.
I was just back from my knee towards the end of it.
Okay, well, the club won it when you were there.
Yeah, John Terry, Pop Green, don't
it? I played in it, like, but I done my knee then.
So who did you, like, if you can remember back to then, were the crowds good? Who did you play? What was the standard of the games like?
Played Glentoran. And I think we, Crusaders on the AstroTurf. See, that's the only thing about up there is the AstroTurf.
Not good for
injured people. AstroTurf's not the best, is it?
Horrendous.
Oh, it's, yeah. Even I feel it.
Horrendous.
I'm
Crusaders one's very good.
Yeah.
Okay.
Their pitch is the best pitch.
Yeah.
That game was the best game. Yeah. The semi-final against you.
What was that, 5-4?
Yeah.
4-2. 4-2 we were beating.
Should have been 5.
And would you foresee, Gav, like, issues, trouble, fan trouble, player trouble, like, if there was to be something, because I'm interested to see how this Champions Cup final goes and what the crowd would be like for that and how that will work.
Brexit's not helping, is it?
No, that's another doubt, of course.
It'll be Linfield anyway. Linfield won the league last year, so it'll be the Rovers or Dundalk. If it's Rovers, they'll be
I'll be supporting Linfield.
I think it's policed well.
Yeah.
If you look at the Bows and Shams games, like, they're policed well now, like, you know. So
yeah, yeah.
I'm sure they can just place it the same, or a couple of extra. Like, you know, I don't think that would be as much as maybe at the start when it's all new, but then as it goes on.
The days are gone, really, to be fair.
You know, I think
at the end of the day, it's just a game of football, isn't it?
And for all of you being from Dublin and playing up north too, and being Irish and that sort of stuff, has there been incidents? Is it all good? And of course, you know, I'm sure at some clubs you'd be very, very welcome, and other clubs maybe not so much because of, you know, different religions, that sort of stuff. How has that been? Is there shouts?
There's been a few dodgy shouts at the Cliftonville games, all right, and air games. But after the games up there, you're brought into the bars, yeah, and given food, and like, everyone's just together, like, so. I haven't seen much trouble. Like, the worst was against, I suppose, Linfield was my first game. I didn't play now, like, I just signed and I was on the bench and I was getting a bit of stick, you know, from fans behind me. I sort of brought it on myself because I was giving a bit back. But after that, then, I haven't really seen it anywhere else.
I suppose it's probably no different. You're going to get stick if you're playing for Shamrock Rovers away to Bowes. It might be a different type of stick, but you're still going to get stick. Like,
oh, I got it, all right.
Owen, for you, have you seen it or found it? Or no, is it all good?
And even, like, in terms of our dressing room, I'd say it's a complete 50-50 in terms of Catholics and Protestants, and the same with the management team, and Lurgan's 50-50 as a town, I think, in terms of the same. So there's been nothing. If anything, actually, Paul Miller, who was our assistant manager, that's now in with Gav at Glentoran, like, and I remember on my first day, he was cracking jokes straight away about it. Everybody. And you know what I mean? I didn't know what to expect going, yeah, up, and he was making jokes about it, and he was a Protestant himself. And I won't repeat all the stuff he was saying, yeah, on air.
That's what they do, isn't it? Everyone cracks jokes about it because it's just seen as...
And it's not a big deal within the clubs. Obviously, fans, you might get a little bit, but I haven't experienced that myself.
Yeah.
Joe?
Well, what I've done in the past, Jamie, is kind of hindered me, but no, look,
he doesn't help himself.
No, I don't.
Yeah, against us, he was kissing the badge and all the air fans giving it to them, wouldn't he?
Yeah, you gotta give a bit.
Did you ask him his jersey number? The reasons why?
What is your jersey number and what's the reasons why?
It's number 32, and it's just for a family reason, that's all.
Okay. Is that correct answer? I can't push him any more on that. So, what have you allegedly done in the past that get you stick from the fans?
Just me 3 years ago, and as at Inverness, just about like that Ross Kemp documentary about the Catholics and Protestants.
Okay.
I wasn't even drunk doing it.
Is it still up or was it deleted?
No, the account was deleted.
Okay.
Actually, I was living with Conor Pepper at the time, and I walked down the stairs and he's in stitches laughing. Adam Evans as well, he was...
But it wasn't taken well by everybody?
No, look, I was stupid at the time, I made my mistake, but with Cliftonville, they love me for it, other clubs they hate me for it, and look, it is, just get on with it. In the past now.
Is social media something, lads, that you're warned about, spoken to about by managers, by clubs? Are you giving help there, you know, playing here, playing in England, playing up north? Is it something that you're... Is there a policy in place about tweets and stuff?
No, I haven't really had any sort of guidance, I think.
It's just common sense now, and don't put anything up, really. Yeah. Leave that to the bloggers, huh?
Everyone's a blogger now.
You are, anyway.
Yeah, well, no. Right, last two questions. You guys have a thing. I'm looking for League of Ireland moments and memories from your times there. I'm going to ask Gav first, because Gavin Peer's role of honour in the League of Ireland is fairly impressive. So, signed for Sligo in 2016. In 2006, sorry, there to 2016. A year at Pats and a year at Derry. At Sligo, League of Ireland title 2012. FAI Cup 2010, 2011, 2013. League Cup 2010 also, and of course his Tanta Cup, which he mentioned he didn't play in too much because he was injured, but that was in 2014. Gav, you got a Sligo testimonial, I do believe, and you are a League of Ireland Sligo legend.
You missed one now. EA Cups,
he doesn't let you forget it either.
Oh. Last year in Derry.
Why didn't you bring them in?
Last year in Derry, correct. Yeah. Didn't even occur to me. Yeah. I'm going to add that to my list right now.
Didn't do your research, did you?
Well, I tried. Trying to research three guests for one interview is a lot of research, but I tried my best. Anyway, talk to me about, like, is it an FAI Cup at Sligo? Is it the league that year in 2012? Is it just being at Sligo for so long? Like, not many League of Ireland players spend 10 years at a club, in the team, winning things, doing well, like.
Yeah, it's hard to, I suppose you want to win the league as a player. It's hard to really pick them out because it was difficult in 2009. We got to the final and lost to Sport Fingal. So that was, we were like, oh no, we're going to struggle probably to get back there, because I think Shams were doing well at the time and Bowes were doing well at the time. Drogheda maybe. So we got into the final, lost in the last couple of minutes to Sport Fingal, and then we went next year and went and won the cup then against Shamrock Rovers in the Aviva, the first of the Aviva, and that was the penalty shootout where Kieran said all the penalties, and I think there was there 36,000 in it or something like that. So yeah, like that was a big occasion. Then you go on then the next year and win it again, you're like, is this going to stop? Because we were going out thinking like, we're not going to be here, like, you know, that was what we felt as a team. And then the following year then to go and win the league, and I think the way we'd done it as well, you know, I didn't lose a game up until we won it, because I was suspended for the one we lost, so I'd gone the whole season without losing. And then to beat your nearest rivals at home in the manner that we did, and then I suppose I got the win penalty as well, so it was, that was, to me that was probably the best occasion. And then I'd probably say other than that was the goal against Bowes in the semi-final to get us into the first final after losing the year before. So that was, for as a personal memory, that was a good one to me. But like, you can't really knock them all. Like, you enjoy winning everything, and I suppose when you don't win, that's when you stop enjoying it, isn't it? You want, as a player, you want to go and win as much as you can.
Owen, for you, you also played for Sligo, a spell at Limerick, and either side of that, we were with Bowes for two spells, having come home from the UK. What would you pick out as a League of Ireland memory? Would that be winning something, a particular game, a goal, being back from injury, whatever that might be?
Yeah, I would say probably my first goal with Bowes against St. Pat's and Dalymount, because it was my first goal in senior football as well, and I think it was only maybe my third game in the league as well, so I think that was a big moment for me, especially given the club that, you know, I still follow, I still try and get to the games and stuff, and you know, that meant a lot to me at the time, like, so it'd have to be that.
What was the goal like?
Wasn't bad. Wasn't a tap in.
It wasn't a tap in.
It wasn't a tap in.
YouTube it after and see. Okay, fair. Joe, for you,
don't do
two spells in the league, Drogheda and Bray.
Yeah.
You were away, you came back, and did you go away again then? Was your spell in the League of Ireland kind of, you
I
know?
I came back, yeah. Summer season after I finished with Inverness, signed for Bray, and the money problem started happening, and I just went back over to Scotland for a bit, and cause most of my pals are over there, so then I signed for Drogheda with Johnny McDonald, and he put me left back there, and it was downhill from there, really.
he put you in the team?
Yeah, at left back.
Okay.
So, no, but look, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed playing up there. It was all right. You know, it was just experience. First team football. I was only 19 at the time. You can't be first team football and these Resi's games and under 18's games. A man, a dog at the side of the pitch. You know, it's unrealistic. So, but no, I did enjoy it. I'd like to give it another go eventually.
Lastly, lads, you've all mentioned that you coach or want to coach. Gav's working for the FAI. Owen is with Bohemians under 30, under 15s.
15s, yeah.
And Joe was hoping to do some coaching up north. Have you coached before, or is it
I've
something?
I've done a bit of coach with Cherry Orchard.
Okay, nice. So, from left to right, Gav, your FAI job, and you're starting in the world of being a coach, yeah, and working in football, you know, not on the pitch as such.
Yeah, I'm enjoying it. My role in the FAI is with the ETB as well, so it's the football and the education side of it, so I'm enjoying that. And no, we'll have a new course starting now. We have one running, probably starting new one in October, just waiting to finalise dates.
So for those listening and watching, the ETB is like a FOSS course, so people who are finished school and they're
unemployed,
they train,
yeah,
they go to gym, they do some education.
Yeah.
Which one are you in, Clondalkin, is it?
No, Lucan.
Okay.
I'm in Lucan, yeah. So I'm enjoying that. And then obviously the football, but then yeah, the coaching. I've actually been offered a few roles, but I still have another year up in Glentoran. There's someone in the league has been in the first division and was on to me to see if I'd be interested going in as an assistant or a player assistant. But I can't really, with my degree and with playing up north, and I suppose with my FAI job, then I haven't really got the time. I have to find time for the kids.
Are you going to reveal when we played each other? IT Blanche B team against Maynooth B team in IT Blanche Cage.
Yeah.
And the result?
Can't remember. That was the B team.
Yeah, you were very well beaten though.
Yours was the A.
Did you even shake hands afterwards?
Yeah. Did, yeah. Did.
That was our B team, by the way.
It wasn't.
Yes, it was.
It wasn't.
I think it could have been.
No chance.
It could be lying.
It wasn't. You were 100% yeah, lying.
But it was not. Was there even a handshake afterwards?
It was, yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Good.
Very annoying on the sideline, your elbow.
Thanks. Owen, for you, you've coached a little bit in the places you've been, at St. Kevin's originally and now with the Bowes. St. Kevin's link up with the 15s, and it's something that you really enjoy, and you're going through your coaching badges as well?
Yeah, I'm currently on the A licence at the moment, so hopefully I'll have that completed now before Christmas. And you know, the age group that I'm working with, the 15s, it's challenging and rewarding at the same time. You know, moody teenagers all down the junior seat at the
over the last little while, yeah?
Yeah, over the last while. So, you know, it's
you know, it's a good age group to work with. A few internationals in the squad as well, so it's some good players, and I'm really enjoying it at the moment. Yeah.
The score lines in some of the underage leagues are quite outrageous, particularly with the top teams. I know in the division you're in 13s and 15s, Bohemians and St. Pat's have beaten Drogheda recently, like 70-0, 30-0, etc. Like, as a coach, how do you prepare your team for a match that everybody knows is going to be a cricket score for your team against the other team? It's not all matches, but it has been some, and it's no use for anybody involved, really.
It's tough because obviously with the schedule of the league and the way it works is you have your first phase, which you have to qualify through and to get into the next phase. So we've just finished phase one and qualified, like you said, along with Pats at the top of our group. So we know that sort of the easier games, those sort of games are maybe hopefully long behind us, and going into the next phase, the games will be more competitive, and you know, there'll be more to play for, because like that, you want the players, playing against the best, but it doesn't necessarily mean that it's working as well. You know, that there is some teams in there that are probably, don't necessarily like to say it, but making up the numbers as such, and you know, but hopefully as it goes on now, the lads will be tested, because that's what you want for your best players, is, you know, compete against the best, and that's where you can really judge them as well.
I don't know how you develop them, but
I don't think winning 17-0 is good for the team losing or the team winning.
But do you have to go and beat them 17-0? Can you keep the ball? Can you work on different things?
Well, the object of football is to score, though.
Yeah, I know, but is there different ways to do it? Like, if you know you're the better, can you work on different things in the game? Like, that's the
well, I'm sure you could. I just think, and, you know, it's a debate that is probably for another day, but in terms of even a 13th in League of Ireland, for me, there has to be a Premier. There has to be the top teams, there has to be the next level. But then you're talking travel and you're talking Cove going to Finn Harps and this sort of stuff, possibly. Because if you look at the majority of the better teams are in and around the Dublin area, you've got Cork, which isn't too far down the road, Waterford and stuff.
Or to choose from, haven't you?
Yeah, but I just don't think, like, if you're the goalkeeper for the team, and it's not just Drogheda, there's other teams too, and you're conceded 17 goals, or you're the striker for Bowes and you've scored 9, and then you get through to the knockout stage and you meet a Pats or you meet someone else, and it's then a really good match. But I also think for the team that isn't so good, it's better for them to be in a game against another average team where in the 80th minute, or they play 35, so in the 60th minute it's still 1-0 or it's nil all, and they actually have a real scenario to deal with, as opposed to the game being over after 50 minutes.
I think if it was tiered, you know, you have, because let's be honest, I think everybody knows sort of what clubs you'd expect to have the stronger teams, particularly at those age groups.
If you match a lesser player with a lesser player playing each other, how are they going to get better, rather than if a lesser player is marking a better player, how is he going to get better?
Yeah, but when the gap is that big, you have to adapt to it.
You have to learn what he's
going to
do.
It's like going back somehow to the DSL, you know, and throwing a B League player or B League team into the Premier. Is that benefiting them? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think Owen's right. I think that the gap for certain teams is so big that it's like a winger playing against a fullback, and every single time he's running past him. And listen, it's something that the FAI need to deal with and need to look at, because it's just, and it happens at 19s as well, and some, you know, in the DDSL before the League of Ireland was ever here, it happened there too, where your top teams were hockeying teams. And it's just something I think could be looked at, and it is a challenge for coaches, you're right, but it's something that I think they could just look at. That's interesting. You're playing up north, but coaching in the League of Ireland, so you're kind of working in both leagues.
So I've got something on every day.
Nice.
Yeah, so our league games would be with Glenavon on a Saturday, and then the other 15 games would be on a Sunday, and then I'm coaching Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and training myself Tuesday, Thursday evening. So
nice.
Yeah, busy man.
Joe, for you, the coaching, tell me about it. What you've done a little bit, but you hope to do some more now, and possibly if you move up north full time.
My next badge is UEFA A.
Okay.
So I'd like, it's a bit of coaching in here, because I haven't really got time with being with Cliftonville, you know. It used to be just Tuesday, Thursday, but now they've added in the extra day. It's hard, but that's why I'm thinking of moving up, because it makes more sense, and I can maybe develop myself as a better coach. But even trying to tell him, like, my little brother and I, he's playing away, and he's going to be going off the Cherry Orchard soon. So it's, I'm just trying to help the kids. That's all it really is.
Nice.
In any way.
And when is this Europa League first qualifying round? July, isn't it?
No, it's the 27th of June.
Is it?
So we've got a friendly against Derry next Friday at the Brandywell.
Okay.
Ards on Monday. Some Welsh team are coming to
us. When's the draw?
Wednesday. Next Tuesday.
Okay.
He's living like a monk at the moment.
We play St. Johnson at the end of June as well. Yeah.
So it's something to look forward to, you know.
Nice. Well, lads, thanks a million for coming in. The best of luck. Enjoy the rest of your off-season, as short as it may be. And best of luck for the new Northern Irish season, and hopefully we'll see you down south again soon. Thanks, lads.
Thanks very much, Eddie.